Good morning. Welcome to St. Timothy Lutheran Church. Today is July 19th, and we are celebrating the seventh Sunday after Pentecost. We begin with confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose steadfast love is everlasting, whose faithfulness endures from generation to generation. Amen.
Amen.
Trusting in the mercy of God, let us confess our sin. Reconciling God, we confess that we do not trust your abundance and we deny your presence in our lives. We place our hope in ourselves and rely on our own efforts. We fail to believe that you provide enough for all. We abuse your good creation for our own benefit. We fear difference and do not welcome others as you have welcomed us. We sin in thought, word, and deed. By your grace, forgive us. Through your love, renew us. And in your spirit, lead us, so that we may live and serve you in newness of life. Amen. Beloved of God, by the radical abundance of divine mercy, we have peace through God, through Christ Jesus, through whom we have obtained grace upon grace. Our sins are forgiven. Let us live now in hope, for hope does not disappoint, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit. Amen. Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all, and also with you. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Help, save, comfort and defend us, gracious Lord. Amen.
This is the feast of victory for our God. Alleluia.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Faithful God, most merciful judge, you care for your children with firmness and compassion. By your Spirit, nurture us who live in your kingdom, that we may be rooted in the way of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Our first reading is from Isaiah 44. Thus says the Lord, the King of Israel and his Redeemer, the Lord of hosts. I am the first and I am the last. Besides me, there is no God who is like me. Let them proclaim it. Let them declare and set it forth before me. Who has announced from of old the things to come? Let them tell us what is yet to be. Do not fear or be afraid. Have I not told you from of old and declared it? You are my witnesses. Is there any God besides me? There is no other rock. I know not one. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God. Psalm 86. Teach me your way, O God, that I may walk in your truth. Give me an undivided heart to revere your name. I give thanks to you, O Lord my God, with my whole heart, and I will glorify your name forever. For great is your steadfast love towards me. You have delivered my soul from the depths of Sheol. O God, the insolent rise up against me. A band of ruffians seeks my life, and they do not set you before them. But you, O Lord, are a God merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness. Turn to me and be gracious to me. Give your strength to your servant. Save the child of your servant girl. Show me a sign of your favor, so that those who hate me may see it and be put to shame. Because you, Lord, have helped me and comforted me. Second reading is from Romans chapter 8. So don't you see that we don't owe this old do-it-yourself life one red cent? There's nothing in it for us, nothing at all. The best thing to do is give it a decent burial and get on with your new life. God's Spirit beckons. There are things to do and places to go. This resurrection life you received from God is not a timid, grave-tending life. It's adventurously expectant, greeting God with a childlike, "What's next, Papa?" God's Spirit touches our spirits and confirms who we really are. We know who he is, and we know who we are, Father and children. And we know we are going to get what's coming to us, an unbelievable inheritance. We go through exactly what Christ goes through. If we go through the hard times with him, then we're certainly going to go through the good times with him. That's why I don't think there's any comparison between the present hard times the coming good times. The created world itself can hardly wait for what's coming next. Everything in creation is being more or less held back. God reins it in until both creation and all the creatures are ready and can be released at the same moment into the glorious times ahead. Meanwhile, the joyful anticipation deepens. All around us, we observe a pregnant creation. The difficult times of pain throughout the world are simply birth pains. But it's not only around us, it's within us. The Spirit of God is arousing within us within. We are also feeling the birth pains. Those sterile and barren bodies of ours are yearning for full deliverance. That is why waiting does not diminish us any more than waiting diminishes a pregnant mother. We are enlarged in the waiting. We, of course, don't see what is enlarging us. But the longer we wait, the larger we become, and the more joyful our expectancy. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God.
To Matthew. Glory to you. put before them another parable. The kingdom of heaven may be compared to someone who sowed good seed in his field. While everybody was asleep, an enemy came and sowed weeds among the wheat, and then went away. So when the plants came up and bore grain, then the wheat, weeds appeared as well. And the slaves of the householder came and said to him, Master, did you not sow good seed in your field? Where then did these weeds come from? He answered, An enemy has done this. The slaves said to him, Then do you want us to go and gather them? But he replied, No, for in gathering the weeds, you would uproot the wheat along with them. Let both of them grow together until the harvest. And at the harvest time, I will tell the reapers, Collect the weeds first and bind them in bundles to be burned, but gather the wheat into my barn. Then he left the crowds and went into the house, and his disciples approached him, saying, Explain to us the parable of the weeds of the field. He answered, The one who sows the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world, and the good seed are the children of the kingdom. The weeds are the children of the evil one, and the enemy who sowed them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the age, and the reapers are angels. Just as the weeds are collected and burned up with fire, so it will be at the end of the age. The Son of Man will send his angels, and they will collect out of his kingdom all causes of sin and all evildoers, and they will throw them into the furnace of fire, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father. Let anyone with ears listen. The Gospel of our Lord. Weeds can be tricky. They can look just like the wheat. I know one time I was working with weeds and I was helping someone and she went right in front of me and pointed out the weeds to me because she had this idea that maybe I wouldn't be able to tell them apart. And she was right. But also, weeds can not only look like the wheat, weeds can have roots that twist around the wheat in the soil. And if you pull up one identified weed, it may bring up five good wheat plants. Why can't life be straightforward so that we can tell the good from the bad? You know, from the early 1920s until the 40s, that was known as the glory time of cowboy films. The movies often portrayed the heroes in white hats or even a white horse, doubly good. And those who wore black hats were obviously the villains. Usually they had a mustache too. And there was obviously a contrast between good and evil. Growing up with these powerful images, many people started to believe that white hats or white skin meant good guy, while dark hat or dark skin meant bad guy. It's not that simple, and it never will be. Few chapters later in Matthew chapter 15, Jesus says, That which goes into the mouth does not defile a person, but what comes out of the mouth defiles a person. Then his disciples came and said to him, Well, do you know the Pharisees are offended after they heard you saying this? And he answered, Every plant which my heavenly Father has not planted will be uprooted. Leave them alone. They are blind leaders of the blind. And if the blind lead the blind, both will fall into the ditch. Within every congregation, every family, every community, and nation, there exists good plants and weeds. In our humanity, we like to delude ourselves into believing that we can tell the difference between the good and the bad. We clearly see the sin or speck in our brother or sister's eyes, but do we notice the log that is in our own? As Jesus says, you hypocrites, first take the log out of your own eye, and then you will see clearly to take the speck out of your brother's eye. Our enemy is never as easy to spot as we would like to believe. What does the Bible say about the enemy? In Matthew chapter 5, Jesus says, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. This is really a huge stumbling block for anyone walking on the path of discipleship. Because if these enemies are destined for a furnace of fire, why should we love them in the here and now? Our God causes the sun to rise on both the evil and the good without distinction. Why is our position to be love? When Jesus sends out his disciples, he tells them that he is sending them out as sheep among wolves. Their enemies may be members of their family. This is our second huge obstacle on the path of discipleship. What makes us enemies of one another? And in such a situation, how do we know if we are the enemy or we are the good? What is it that determines which we are? I have never met a person so holy as to be free of sin. I find that the older a person gets, the more they can radiate this wonderful love of Christ. But that's Christ reflected through them. Not necessarily, and not even them on their own. You know, in our Lutheran theology, we say that we are at the same time saint and sinner. Because of Christ. This realization is enough to make us take off our white hats and recognize our inability to be the savior of the world or even a gardener. Jesus is the savior, and we are merely lights that flicker on and off in a world of suffering and pain. This should not lead us to despair, because God has pointed out exactly who we are. God brings us to life here and now, in a place where we can be truly the people God has called us to be. You see, the Holy Spirit calls us to enter into God's amazing abundant life through our baptismal calling. Stop being focused on the dead ends in your life. Stop being that armchair quarterback yelling at the people out there. And start living in excitement and greeting every day with, what's next, Papa God? What's next? God's Spirit touches our spirits and confirms who we really are. We know who He is, and we know who we are, Father and children. Through the power of the Spirit to direct our days and deeds, we are given a great privilege, and this is to be brothers and sisters across cultures, races, nationalities, genders, ethnicities, and even political divides. We can wake up each morning and say, what's next, Papa? What's next, Mama? It's a faithful way to begin your day. And the Holy Spirit even sets not only a framework for us personally, but for our entire congregation. In his letters, Paul stresses the importance of listening to the Holy Spirit as a prerequisite for framing ministry. Here's the thing. The Holy Spirit leads us to greater understanding and wisdom in the ways of God. I am called by God to submit to the power of the Spirit first and foremost. Today we face horrific obstacles caused by seasons of political, economic, and social transitions. With the grace and power of God through the Holy Spirit, we will be allowed to pass through and will glorify God in all we do because Jesus glorified God even when he was going through his own suffering, death, and resurrection. The Holy Spirit will always sustain the church and its members, even in times of storms and challenges. If you're looking for a straightforward life, let go of your need to weed the world. Drop your white hat and put on a mask and say, Papa, what's my next step? Mother God, what shall we do in our congregation? You'll still face conflict because the world is not keen on God's justice. But we are and always will be advocates of justice, mercy, and love. For we are the children of the Lord. Amen. Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. We continue with the prayers of the church.
Confident of your care and helped by the Holy Spirit, we pray for the church, the world, and all who are in need. God of the harvest, you sow the good seed of the gospel of Jesus Christ into your field. Help your church throughout the world to be both diligent and patient, full of resolve and gentleness, that our witness may be faithful to your intentions. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of all space and time, your whole creation groans in labor pains. awaiting the gift of new birth. Renew the earth, sky, and sea, so that all your creation experiences freedom from the bondage of decay. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of the nations, teach us your ways, that we may walk in your truth. Mend the fabric of the human family, now torn apart by fearful and warring ways. Guide us by your mercy, grace, and steadfast love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of hope, you accompany those who suffer and are near to the brokenhearted. Open our hearts to your children who are lonely and abandoned, who feel trapped by despair, and all who suffer in any way, especially Wanda Catini, Jerry Gandhi's friend, Steve, Kathy Nicola, Jennifer Buchanan, Don Collins, Ben Richard, Jack Cassanese, Michael Packin, Joanne M., Dick and Mary Ball, Robert Miller, Carol Glaser, Lorraine Fole, Jane Boris, Mason V., Jerry Peake, Tamara Proctor, Cheryl Rosati, Jim Olmsted, Robin Aronica, Rosaria Philippone, Robin Bengalia Richard, the Maris family, the family of Adam McMillan, Sylvia and Joe Smith, Deborah Sora, Charlene Valesky, and those we name out loud and in the silence of our hearts. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of the seasons, in the midst of summer, give us refreshment, renewal, and new opportunities. We pray for the safety of those who travel. We pray for those who cannot take the rest they need. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of life, those who have died in you, shine like the sun in your endless kingdom. We remember with thanksgiving the saints of all times and places and saints close to us. Gather us with them on the day of salvation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In the certain hope that nothing can separate us from your love, we offer these prayers to you. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you all, and also with you. Thank you for your continuing faithful spiritual practice so that we can continue our mission. If you have not given online or would like to move to Giving Plus by Vankel or Tithely, please do so. I know Steve and I have moved to Giving Plus, and it has been a great way for us to be faithful in our giving and to know that everything is being taken care of for us during this difficult time.
God of goodness and growth, all creation is yours, and your faithfulness is as firm as the heavens. Water and word, wine and bread, these are signs of your abundant grace. Nourish us through these gifts that we might proclaim your steadfast love in our communities and in the world. Through Jesus Christ, our strength and our song. Amen.
The Lord be with you, and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. With all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. He was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, gave it for all to drink, saying, this cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me. For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Remembering, therefore, his salutary command, his life-giving passion and death, his glorious resurrection and ascension, and the promise of his coming again, we give thanks to you, O Lord God Almighty, not as we ought, but as we are able. We ask you mercifully to accept our praise and thanksgiving, and with your word and Holy Spirit to bless us, your servants, and these your own gifts of bread and wine, so that we and all who share in the body and blood of Christ may be filled with heavenly blessing and grace, and receiving the forgiveness of sin, may be formed to live as your holy people and be given our inheritance with all your saints. To you, O God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be all honor and glory in your holy church, now and forever. Amen. Let us remember you in your kingdom and make us bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Receive nourishment for your journey. The body of Christ given for you, I ask you now to take the bread that you have before you and to eat it. The blood of Christ shed for you. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. The board will be meeting at 6:30 tomorrow night. This Friday at 7 p.m. will be a time for us to get together and talk about the outdoors. Share some ideas about biking, boating, birdwatching, fishing, hiking, and other outdoor activities. My favorite ones, stare at bugs and point them out to everyone. That's my favorite. Should probably point at birds instead of bugs, but bugs are easier to see. All right, now it's holiday week at our childcare center, and Wednesday will be Halloween. So if you are able, grab your trunk or treat, set up costume, candy, and car, and join us at 10 a.m. There'll be about 45 kids. And so it's just a matter of wearing your mask and then a mask, a double mask, and having some candy in the back of your trunk. I know the kids will really enjoy that. Again, the parking lot's closed on Fridays. Trinity's Feed the Hunger drive-by food pickup will be July 25th from 11 to 1. Also, we are still gathering food and COVID supply drive for Community of Good Neighbors and Resurrection Village Food Pantry. We received two items this morning at the 8 o'clock service. And Miranda Hammer, who was a pastor when she was with us, is now a reverend. She was ordained on Saturday. So we rejoice with her and the Community of Good Neighbors and Resurrection Village Food Pantry. And here's our final hymn. In all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. Amen. God the Creator, Jesus the Christ, and the Holy Spirit the Comforter bless you and keep you in eternal love. Amen.
Go in peace. Christ is with you. Thanks be to God.
All right, everybody on mute. Oh, there's everybody. And now we can now pretend we're having coffee. Wait.
We are.
We are. Iced coffee. Let's see. Is there
a question.
Pepsi or a Pepsi? What am I seeing, Tracy the Great?
I have a question. Mm-hmm. I have a question.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Whenever you guys sing, I can't hear it. Am I doing something wrong?
No, not exactly. Kim, would you like to take that?
Well, so Nick records the hymns, and then usually Mom and I sing. We record over top of his recording. So that's what, can you hear words?
I hear nothing.
Really?
It's just like you, and you're both, on my computer screen, you guys and excuse me, and Pastor are muted. Literally, the mute button is there, and I'm hearing nothing, and I'm seeing nothing, and everybody's singing, and I don't know where it's coming from. Like, no music, but I don't know what they're singing off of. Does everybody have a sheet?
Or are you? It should be. It's on the PowerPoint.
Can you see the PowerPoint?
Can you see the PowerPoint that has
for the whole service?
You don't have it on for the whole service.
No, I saw at one point. I saw when you left and then put something on, and all I could see was, like, you know how that timing, waiting, and then nothing came up for me. I don't know.
Does anybody else have a problem?
No, we see fine and hear also.
Pastor finished her sermon and you guys came back on, it took probably about a minute and a half to go from Donna is sharing to actually showing on my screen.
Yeah. I don't know. For some reason, it just completely mutes out all the singing. And I have I don't know what I'm doing. I'm on an iPad.
Did you hear any of the singing before the sermon?
Oh, yes, I have before. This is about the second or third service that I've been shut out of. And I'm always wondering. I have no idea what I'm doing wrong. I'm on an iPad, so.
Have you been on the iPad all the weeks or just recently?
When Pastor unmutes herself, I can hear. So it's really weird.
I'm not singing during the hymns. I mean,
Yeah, so you should only hear what's being shared through my computer. So you shouldn't hear anyone
singing. No, I don't hear anyone. I don't hear anything. So that's all. I don't know.
Okay.
If I'm missing something, I don't know. If there's a setting, maybe, that I'm not doing.
Well, that just turned the camera off.
Yeah, I was trying to find a setting. That's okay. Maybe I'll start doing it on my phone or something.
Sorry, Buster.
Okay, back to chatting.
Back to chatting. Well, we've eaten all the cookies now, so.
You know, Pastor, I got to tell you, you were talking about the cowboy movies from the 20s and 30s where the good guys had a white hat and the bad guys had a black hat. That's how everybody sees it. It's either black or white, either good or bad. Well, from a technology standpoint, I am what they call a certified ethical hacker, which basically means I am what's called a gray hat. I'm neither white nor black. Hacking is technically using computers for things that it wasn't meant to be used for. So some people would look at it as being bad, but the purpose of me doing certain hacking things is good. So that's why, you know, you can't, it's not black or white. Sometimes there's a gray area.
Like the time you were, would you say that when you were practicing on Macintoshes or Apple computers, you were hacking?
No, that wasn't really a hacking tool. To give you an example, one of my former pastors, he had a computer that had a fingerprint reader. And it had a backup password. Well, the fingerprint reader wouldn't work, and he couldn't remember his password. So I put a tool in his computer, and I hit a few buttons, and I unlocked his computer without typing in his password.
There you go.
That's hacking.
Yeah.
But technically, it was a good thing because he asked me to do that. So.
So that would be ethical hacking.
That's ethical hacking, yes. So that's gray hat, neither black nor white.
I don't know, sound like a savior to me.
Sounds like it's true of life. A lot of grays in the life.
Yes, exactly.
There are.
And a lot of us are.
We try to make it much clearer.
Everybody, Everybody has to see it black or white. Nobody can just accept the gray area.
So this past week, I found a TED Talk. That's kind of a nice segue because it's a TED Talk called The Beauty and Complexity of Finding Common Ground. You know, the black hat, the white hat. You have to find you have to find the gray hat in the middle. And it is, I can't remember, oh, Matt Trombley is his name. And he speaks to something I had not heard in this context before, and it's called agonism, where if you wear a white hat and you are speaking with someone who wears a white hat, all of a sudden you believe everything about them is white. Everything about them is good. I mean, white as being good. And if you find someone wearing a black hat, it's much easier for us to demonize them without actually understanding where they're coming from. And this gentleman says that maybe what we need to say is, can we have a cup of coffee? Can we sit down and talk about where we might meet in the middle? And even if we never totally agree, at least we can understand somebody else's perspective. I think there's a lot more chance that we could get along. It's only 14 minutes long.
And it's a TED Talk?
It's a TED Talk, and it's called The Beauty and Complexity of Finding Common Ground. And if you type in Trombley, T-R-O-M-B-L-E-Y, it will pop up. And it's really quite engaging and was really very interesting.
Thank you.
And that's the problem that we have. It's everybody has their own opinion, and if you don't agree with their opinion, you're automatically wrong.
Exactly.
Nobody wants to sit and have a conversation.
Yep. And well, and he was funny. He was funny when he said that actually you can understand why the word agony comes from this whole thought process, because that's what many of us feel like we're living through right now. Maybe even less in the COVID and more in the political. You know, it's a difficult time.
Some people do not want common ground. It's either my way or my way, kind of thing.
Yeah, that's a good point.
And once you set up that fence, you know, you're pretty much going to be behind that fence for the rest of your days.
Yeah.
Okay, now we're moving on to the chocolate brownies. Remember, we're done with the cookies, so now we're imagining we've got brownies.
I've just never had wine on my patio at 10 o'clock in the morning before. You know, it just was kind of a lovely new addition to my life.
the only time I had wine was the first time I had communion at your church.
Did I warn you?
No, I think it was Jack Skinner that warned me that it was real wine.
Okay.
Because at Trinity, we don't use real wine. We use grape juice.
Yeah.
I have had it where I will, sometimes a friend will have a Methodist friend with them, and I'll be looking at them like, now this is going to be wine, so don't go, ooh, right afterwards, okay? Loses something in the translation when you go, woo.
Yeah. And I want to say that I think the addition of the singing from the Jaeger family is absolutely wonderful.
Well, we just got to get that out to Carol Kraft.
Yes. Yeah.
I was going to say it's wonderful, but I'm not here.
Trust me, Carol.
Because you know
when we sign language, girls.
Because when we all try to sing and we all hear it, what it does is it cuts out all the voices. Yeah.
Do you know what, Pastor? There is this afternoon, there is a conductor, and I don't remember his name, but he is debuting a 17,000-member international choir singing his composition, and I think it's called Sing Gently. Yeah. It's on YouTube. I don't know what time they're debuting it, but
Sing,
S-I-N-G, Sing Gently. 17,000 voices, and it exactly addresses what you talked about, cutting in and out, because this gentleman wrote this song, then he recorded the accompaniment, he put it out there for whoever wanted to learn it, They all individually recorded themselves singing it with him conducting on whatever video screen, and they put the whole thing together. 17,000 wow. voices singing Sing Gently.
Wow.
So I'm going to look for it this afternoon.
Yeah. Me too. Thanks for that.
Carol,
that
maybe you'll be able to hear it.
I really hope so.
No, Carol, we were just talking. Maybe, have you tried YouTube, like after the service? See if you can get it.
Well, I mean, I sit, you know, no, I haven't, because I'm here for the service and I just watch you guys.
Yeah.
So
I'm just wondering if you're getting the sound then.
Oh, I see what you mean.
You know,
I could check. I don't know. It's really weird because everybody's muted when you guys are singing. Like I can see the mute button, and when she unmutes, then I can hear her. So I have no idea.
Everybody is muted during the singing,
including Donna.
Yeah.
You are
because it's pre-recorded with the music.
Well, I'm hearing nothing, so.
Okay.
Nothing.
Do you hear the music at all?
No.
I wonder maybe if Donna unmutes.
Well, I'm not singing, though. The thing is that recorded and it's part of the PowerPoint.
If we sing at the same time as the accompaniment, right.
Yeah, you'd be
so
off.
Yeah. So I'm not getting the PowerPoint. Is what
yeah,
it is.
Yeah. That's what's
okay.
But we'll do a troubleshoot thing later. But but Carrie, Eric Whitaker is a composer that did that a couple years ago. I don't know if it was.
That's who it is. That's Eric. Who it is.
Yes. He has a couple on YouTube already. That
he started out with 500. He had one that was 8,000, 9,000, and now it's 17,000.
That's pretty incredible.
It's amazing. Eric Whitaker. That's the guy. Oh. This young brain, you would know that.
Everybody ready to go to the world?
Yep.
Yeah.
I know you said no.
Bye, everybody.
Bye,
Pastor.
Hello.
Pastor, tell you, Pastor, spot on, wonderful, wonderful message. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I agree.
Thank you.
Very, very meaningful.
Thank you.